because the house always wins. Play long enough, you never change the stakes. The house takes you, unless when that perfect hand comes along, you bet and you bet big. Then you take the house. Oh, and thrive loud with Lou Diamond.
Would you like to learn from those that are taking their lives, their businesses, and their passions to the next level? Best-selling author of Speakeasy and Master Connector, Lou Diamond is here to connect you to some of the most inspiring and amazing people on this planet. Get ready to thrive loud with Lou Diamond.
Welcome, everyone, to another amazing, fantastic, absolutely awesome episode of Thrive Loud with Lou Diamond. Connecting you to the most inspiring and amazing people that are thriving each and every day. I'm your host, Lou Diamond, and today on Thrive Loud, we have a man that believes business is a game and connects game theory and success in sales. He's a popular speaker at business meetings and is the author of Why They Follow and co-author of Rainmaker Confidential. He is the host and producer of the Rainmaking Podcast and has been a successful entrepreneur in the recruiting industry for many years. Thrive Loud listeners, we are going to make it rain here on Valentine's Day. Thrive Loud listeners, I bring you my good friend, Scott Love. Scott.
Thank you, Lou.
How are you?
I'm great. Thanks for having me here.
Scott is awesome. Let me tell you why Scott's awesome. You're going to learn it for yourself. You're going to hear his whole story. He's got an energy level. He's an unbelievably successful entrepreneur and business person. But most notably, he is one of the best connectors I've met. He will go and meet you when he knows you're going to be in town. He makes the effort. And it was in that effort that he and I like finally got to chit-chat and reconnect. And I'm like, how have I not had you on Thrive Loud yet? He goes, because I have something I'm working on I want to talk about. I said, great. We're going to hit that when we can. So here's what I want to do, Scott. You've got a great story. I kind of want to do a little rewind, hit into how you got into the business that you've been so successful in and how it's bled into so many other things and so many great things in your life. Is that a fair way to kick
yeah,
things
sure.
off?
Yeah, sure. Sure. So I started recruiting back in 1995. I remember buying a fax machine to fax resumes to clients. Before that, I was doing sales. I worked in telecom sales, a company called BTI. And they had this fantastic sales training course. We spent 2 weeks learning how to sell a commodity at margins higher than our competitors. It was classic sales training. Before that, I was a naval officer. I'm a graduate of the Naval Academy. Dr. Mary Kelly, she was my second class when I was at Believe. She and I go way back to 1985, I think. And so I got into recruiting in 1995. I started doing really well. I ended up starting a training company, a sales training company, training recruiting organizations and staffing organizations in 2002. I sold it in 2016. I got back into the actual work of doing recruiting because a lot of my consulting and training clients were legal search firms. Yeah. And I know your wife used to do that.
That is true.
And so I saw, hey, that's interesting. I like the economic opportunity. I like talking to lawyers. They're smart, guarded people that hate change and are risk averse. So how hard can it be? And I started that in 2009, and I love it. I go to bed Sunday night because I'm playing a game all day. There's more poker theory in legal recruiting than there is in a real game of poker, Lou. So I recruit law firm partners. I merge groups. I do law firm mergers. I'll merge a small firm into a big firm. So I absolutely love the work. And just like you, I'm a professional connector, connecting them in a different way, a very more specific way. And from that, I've learned a lot in business that I like to share with people.
Yeah. First of all, I love it. I love the game theory and poker piece. Yeah. So that I want to dive a little into this. I want to double click down. Help explain to our listeners that process in game theory, that poker, if you would, that you're going to sleep on Sunday night trying to plan for that week. Explain why that's applicable into the line of work that you deal with.
Yeah, absolutely. Because we cannot control the outcome. We have no control over how things are going to transpire. What do we have control over? The decisions that we make and the actions that we take. We don't know how the flow of cards is going to come out, but we can learn. I remember spending time with a professional poker player years ago, and I was kind of shadowing him. And he would say that all he's doing, you know, I asked him, what sort of goals do you set for yourself? Do you set financial goals? And he said, I don't. I only care about two things, learning something and making correct decisions. Even if I don't win, if I learn something, that's a win. And so we can't control how people are going to respond to when we sell, but how do I get better odds? By learning how to communicate, by learning how to listen. Yeah. And basically what I tell law firm partners, I say, I channel your self-interests so it intersects with law firm strategy. So what I try to do is to find out what is it that they want, what goals do they have, and showing them that I'm the one that can help them reach those goals. So we can't control it. So it's all about influencing it.
So I love this only because I've lived this. And when I say I live this, I'm going to say I live this vicariously through my wife. As right. Scott mentioned, my wife was a legal recruiter in the, let's say, the mid 90s into the early 2000s. And she was damn good at it. And a lot of it was her ability to connect with a lot of the attorneys. And you made a great point, very risk averse. And a yeah. lot of that world, for those who are not attorneys or not familiar with this, you know, working in those big firms, and they're very set on the schools they went to and the type yeah. of law they deal with, and getting people to move is really difficult. But meanwhile, those moves are really important because yeah. when they do make them, they're really finding the right fit. They're from their practice and what they like. So being able to matchmake yeah. is really cool. But what I love,
absolutely right, yeah, absolutely right.
What I love about what you hit home is this unpredictability of not knowing yeah. and not having the control, and versus taking it as a negative, you've mm-hmm. spun this thing into kind of this positive. And just, I love those two things. Can you repeat them again? Because they were awesome. The two yeah. things you need to learn. Yeah.
As long as I make correct decisions and learn something, it's a win.
I love it. So when it comes to your own business, in making these decisions and developing your own things, right? There are probably more things that you could control, even though you can't really control anything. Have you found that you've been able to drink your own Kool-Aid and be able to your own career and the things that you control? I actually feel like you do have a good sense of control, or yeah. have you pulled a fast card on me, Scott?
Well, one thing I've done when I was in the Navy, I was, for my first job, I was third in command of a U.S. Navy ship. When I was 22 as USS Fortify, then my second tour was on my shore duty tour. I was in the right place at the right time. The Navy in the early 90s had an initiative called Total Quality Leadership, which was a derived model from Total Quality Leadership by W. Edwards Deming. This was an initiative in the early 90s where the Navy realized that some of their traditions aren't exactly good traditions, like tailhook, and so they needed to change. So I was in the right place at the right time, Lou. I was a trainer at the world's largest naval base, teaching them how to understand statistical process control. Whatever you measure can improve. Checklists, flow charts, Pareto charts, things like that. So basically what I did when I was 24, at the age that you actually do know everything, Lou, I would go around to all these different military and civil service commands and teach them these concepts. So in my own business, I track things, I measure things, I find out what is that data. And so I try to have a business mindset to my own world in measuring what are the things that I can control and what are the things that I can't. And here's an example of this. If I had a time travel machine to where I could go to the future and I could find out which partner decided that day he or she wants to move, I would go to my time travel machine and I would call them the day they decided to move. And if I knew, and so I look for data that tells me who is likely to be more receptive to my call, who's been with the firm that announced that they're going to be merging with a different firm and they might be more open to it. So I try to look for indications of a high likelihood of a favorable outcome. The other thing, because there's so many people that do what I do, they're going to make a judgment about my effectiveness based on the thought leadership I have. They don't know if what a good recruiter is or a good recruiter is not. But if they see a lot of thought leadership, they're going to make a decision. Well, this person has more credibility because they're on Lou Diamond's podcast. And so they can see. And so I try to do things like that through authorship, through my own podcast, speaking at legal conferences. I've met with over 60 law firms in person. So I try to do things that give me a greater advantage. I can't predict which deals are going to close. And so I try to actually take actions so that my odds of a success in my work are increased.
Okay. And this is exactly what I'm thinking. Think about this, listeners. What I love about Scott, he obviously, he's got his core business. He has written books about it. He speaks about this exact theory and the game theory piece, which comes from an interesting background. We'll talk about that very shortly. And on top of that, he also puts himself out there with this incredible, the Rainmaking podcast, where he gets to connect with some of the best rainmakers out there. I had a great opportunity to be on his amazing program.
You're a great guest, Lou.
We had a lot of fun. Well, as are you. Yeah. And this is what I wanted you on the show, because I wanted listeners to get this. And that's what I want to do this rewind. Can you obviously have a good understanding of the game theory, and you talked about all the stuff in your business piece. Can we dive a little bit down into the card
Absolutely.
Piece a little bit? Because you've had an interesting life and things that you focused on before all this.
Absolutely. And one thing I'm not a speaker that's going to speak more than 10 to 15 times a year to non-legal groups. I mean, I have my business, like you said, but when I had my training company, I would train recruiting firms. I'd probably been in 125 different offices, over 4,500 recruiting and staffing companies from 36 countries, invested in my tapes back in the day, VHS, then online learning and all that. And so I'd seen a lot. And sometimes when I would go to Vegas to speak at sales meetings, I'd get there a day early because I want to be a good speaker and be fresh. And I saw all these games with names like craps. Gosh, that sounds kind of scary. And roulette, that sounds even worse. And you have no control over the outcome. But I'd read books that in the game of blackjack, there's a defect that if you understand the math behind it, you can actually exploit the casinos legally, as long as you don't use electrical or mechanical equipment. Just by keeping track of the math in your head, you can gain an advantage. So I taught myself how to count cards. I reached out to two former alumni of the MIT blackjack team. Yeah. And I said, I'll consult to your business. They had a business. I'll consult to you. And I won't charge you. You help me with my game and you won't charge me. And so we bartered. So for a year and a half, they mentored me. So I've been kicked out of casinos. I've been banned from casinos. And I don't play it at all. I played it for a year and a half and I burned out. I just didn't like sitting in a smoky environment doing math equations for 8 or 9 hours at a time. You know, being around people that are loud and all that. But what I loved was making decisions and seeing that there's a tangible result. Yeah. Because I know what the future is in the game of blackjack, because it's finite. Yeah. And we know that there's a certain number of cards and there's a ratio between high value, low value cards. I can keep track of that and just through the math, gain a high likelihood of a favorable outcome. Make decisions. Put money on the felt when you know that your odds are high and bet in proportion to advantage. And when the count goes low or negative, remove yourself from the equation. Yeah. Don't play. Why would you play and put money on the felt unless you have a favorable outcome? So that's my whole approach to business also. And I've been telling that story when I'd speak to sales groups for years. And people love it because it's interesting. And I try to make it about what is it that you want? You want more sales. Well, what are the variables that you have? And you have to think of it this way, Lou. Which variables do you have control over? And which variables do you not have control over? And I talk about it that way. Let's look at the six different variables related to a conversation with you and a client prospect. Number one, what do they think about? What do they say? What do they do? And what actions do they take? How much control do you have over that? None. The other two variables, what do you think about and what do you do? How much control do you have over what you think about and what you do and what you say and how well you do it? You have 100% control. So you increase your skills in the things that you have control over that give you a greater edge in the game of sales.
Yeah, I want to hit one of the interesting things because, yes, you got a great ability to increase the likelihood of winning the business, winning the client, winning the keynote address that you're lobbying for or whatever. And you're very good in keeping that formulaic way of doing it. Now, emotion. Let's make it clear that when I'll use the legal recruiting space, look, you've found the right candidate. You've found the the right firm. There's a good match. That candidate gets put into that firm. And by the way, for those who don't know this, guys like Scott might not get paid until these people have been there for a certain amount of time. Yeah. And by the way, there's a lot of things out of your control, whether they're going to accept the offer or not, yeah. and you can help persuade. But obviously, you feel good when you win and you get it right, and they say yes. I want to talk about when things don't go your way. How do you manage the emotions of the stuff when, because it is a very time-invested business on the legal recruiting side or any of the decisions in sales. How do you personally manage the bad outcome, the ones that will happen no matter what, because you can't control it. You just did the best components of what you can do. How does it feel to you when you don't win?
It feels good if I made correct decisions and made the correct actions, and if I learned something. And I'm grateful for the experience of going to a four-year college where everything you do is structured adversity. So at a young age, you learn how to deal with adversity and you build your resilience muscles. So now we're entering into the world of managing one's emotions, emotional intelligence. How do you manage your own emotions effectively and positively influence the emotions of other people? This is something I've taught my kids, my 22-year-old boy, my 11-year-old little girl, is that we have a choice. No matter how bad things get, we have control over how we choose to respond. How much control do we have over how we choose to respond? 0 to 100%. You have 100% control over the choice you make to respond to that situation. When I'm reading about something that happened in this chapter, was it good or was it bad? I had 3 counteroffers take place years ago in one day, Lou. Candidate accepts an offer, they turn their notice in, and the employer says, it's funny you're going to give your notice today. We actually were going to pay you a double top secret bonus tomorrow. Let's just go ahead and pay that to you now, and let's forget this whole thing ever happened. And I had 3 people do that in one day. Mm. And I remember my wife, I felt bad for her knocking on the bathroom door, wondering, am I okay? I remember crying so bad, Lou, that I'm thinking, I'm crying so bad. I'm like, oh man, my abs are going to look so good tomorrow because I'm crying so hard. I mean, and I remember kind of feeling sorry for myself. And I remember when that happened, I said, you know, I guess it's like this grieving process. And this is when I was in the business, maybe 2 years, I was probably 29 years old. And it was a grieving process. I'm upset. How could they do this to me? They're so selfish. Those selfish candidates. What about my need? It was my commission. How could they do that to me? It was like shock and disbelief and anger. And then finally, acceptance. And I remember this. I said, I guess it's just every man for himself. I guess they're just going to do what they're going to do anyways. And a light bulb went on and said, absolutely right. They're going to do what they're going to do anyway. So why not try to find out and harness that intrinsic energy that exists within them and harness that energy and let that energy drive the whole sales process and recruiting process forward. And I found out how to keep those from happening to me with a very high likelihood because of that bad experience. Was it good or was it bad? Well, if you turn the pages to 2 chapters later, I started a training company. And wow, because of that, I was able to get this and I was able to get this. So you look back and you say, I'm so glad that didn't work out because I wouldn't have learned this, which led to this. So I think it's developing the habit, automatic instinct. This is the difference between people in sales or business that are number one in the world and everybody else. It's, I think there's a few things. One of those is just making one more call before you leave the office. The other thing is being able to ask good questions and articulate your value, but tied in with it through their lens. But then the third is looking at this bad situation that happened and being able to recover within minutes, like 3 or 4 minutes, instead of, I can't believe I lost $50,000. Well, you shouldn't spend the money on your head until you get it. Don't do that. And so there's all the habits, and this is what I've seen just by having that experiential base of being in so many offices and consulting and coaching to so many people. I've seen what they've done. And then another tip that I'll give, and I'll be quiet now because I'm doing a seminar, Lou, on emotional resilience, having tools that help you that are your immediate habits, such as one thing I do when we have these things happen is I ask myself questions, simple questions, such as, who loves me? My wife and kids, who do I love? My wife, and what am I truly grateful for? And being able to anchor that so I can quickly bounce back from adversity. Another tool I have, I think of my friend Patrick. We were both acolytes in the same Episcopal parish, St. David's in Austin, Texas. We were both Boy Scouts, but in different troops, 14 years old. We were good friends. He goes on a camping trip, jumps into a pond headfirst, and breaks his neck. Ooh. And I still remember visiting him in the hospital. I still remember the smells. And he died when he was 17. And so I think of him. I'm like, he never had this chance to have a sail fall apart. How bad are my problems? Come on. Really? So how bad are my problems? My problems? You know, clients that forget to pay me and that's about it. And they'll make it up and they won't forget again. That's it. And so I try to find those anchor moments, and I don't want to minimize the significance and call it a tool, but it's something that I use that quickly brings me back into a state of contentment.
I love it.
Yeah. And then I this is something I teach my kids. My final seminar tip for the day is having...
our listeners are benefiting. We're going to have more than that. Keep going. Yeah, sorry. Sorry for interrupting.
Having a mantra, I choose not to let external circumstances govern my emotions. Yeah. Why would I let an external circumstance govern how I feel? And so I think I find even at the card table, you know, just... I'm not going to let that bother me. I'm going to let it roll off my back like water off a duck's back, yeah. Or when things happen in business. And I think just those abilities, those skills are extremely attractive to people. I think it draws people to us. When people see you've got inner strength, they want that. Seminar's over, Lou. Seminar's over.
Listeners, hopefully you enjoyed all this. Well, let's just recap.
Self-awareness seminar. Yeah.
Let's just recap this. And everyone who's putting this picture together here of Scott, we not only had him as a Boy Scout, as a kid who eventually went to the Naval Academy and obviously even understood the math of dealing with gambling, of playing in a blackjack and all the rules in casinos and using those things to your advantage, and then spinning that into a legal career and obviously also a speaking career to teach all of this great theory and all this, by the way. And, let's not forget that he also has done stand-up comedy, my friends. He practices on open mic nights at different places. And by the way, it's pretty funny. I caught a bunch of your act.
Thank you.
It was pretty good. Thanks. You also, on top of all of that, are a great listener. And you've now channeled that into...
I'm sorry, what'd you say, Lou?
Exactly. No, I knew it was coming. That was bump set spike. You've channeled this into the Rainmaking Podcast.
Yeah.
I love asking authors certain questions around the fact that when they came out with their book, there was an accident, there was a happy accident, if you would, that came out that was obviously your book was a gift to the reader. But when you wrote it, it actually, there turned out to be a happy accident gift for yourself. I want to spin that same question for being the host and producer of the Rainmaking Podcast. Great listen. Everyone's got to go check this out. We'll put all the links in the show notes. We'll do it in the plug section. Scott Love, though, what is the happy accident and gift that you've had with the Rainmaking Podcast?
I would say learning how to be significant to other people. I have something that can help you. And I'm really proud of what I've done with that. I've started podcasting in 2009, Lou. I had with my recruiter training company, I didn't even know what I was doing. I mean, I'm embarrassed to, it was just awful, but I did something and it drove people to buy my coaching services back when I used to do that. But I like creating something that has real substance, it has equity. There's true value to it. And I've got two goals. One is to put my content in the minds of law firm partners, because they don't care about moving or talking to a head owner until they want to move, but they care about getting more business all the time. That's why I interview a lot of coaches and other successful rainmakers to kind of keep connection with them. But then secondly, being able to help everybody else that is in sales, that's in business development, just through ideas. And I found the happy accident for me, Lou, is just sitting at the feet of smart people like you and learning. And I'm proud of the equity that I built with that. I'm proud of that. I'm proud that I can give something to people that I'm not ashamed of. Mm. And here it is. This is good because it's going to help you and you need to listen to this. And being able to talk with law firm partners. And, you know, I meet with the law firm chairman. I send them a note after our meeting or our dinner, and with the signed copy of my book that came from my podcast, Mark DeVries and Mark LeBlanc and Henry DeVries, two pals of mine, I'd had them on the show. They said, let's write another book together. And that came out of that. So you never know. Sometimes it's the surprising benefit. You just have to do something. You just have to walk forward. You're going to make a lot of mistakes and take the advice of people that have done it. Like, you helped me out quite a bit, Lou. And I really appreciate all of your advice and help on that too.
Yeah. I want to do the signature question on this program, because to decode a gentleman like this, who I just gave the full bio of, and you've gotten all listeners, you've got an understanding of not only how well-rounded, but how logically it seems like it's all over the place, but there's actually a rhyme and reason to all of the things that he does, and is an incredible connector using every one of the skills. So what I love about Scott is his ability to just rein it all in, which means, and that's why he is here on Thrive Loud, because he's thriving on most days. But we all have those days, Scott, when we're a little off our game, where, you know, no matter what's going on and what the odds are on the felt, we might not make the right decision and the deal might not happen.
Yep.
Scott Love, when you have trouble thriving, what practice do you seek, or which individual do you seek out to get yourself back on the thriving track?
I think for me, knowing when I need to go within and when I need to sit and journal. And if you don't have a journal, I'd recommend you get a journal. Get a nice leather-bound book. Get a nice expensive fountain pen, something that you really enjoy writing with, unless you're left-handed. And I'd say that is where you have a conversation with yourself about your about your disappointments, about your fears, challenges, frustrations, also your victories. Yeah. I do that. I think a prayer for me and my faith helps, especially with my wife. Praying with her and talking to her. Then also, I got to tell you, don't be so macho that you don't go and see somebody like a professional counselor just to get stuff off your chest, because it builds up and it can lead you to make unhealthy decisions, of which I've made a lot in my life, Lou. And those are things we don't have to talk about today, but we've all done that. And you need to learn from that. One other thing I've done, I mean, this isn't related to your question, but I also think I keep a column on an Excel spreadsheet, or multiple columns. I've done this every day since 2017. I'll document certain metrics associated with my business, but then two other things I'd recommend that you do also. Number one, I write down what was my greatest achievement for the day. Mm. What was one thing I did really well? I'll document that. My next column is what was my lesson learned? Usually it's something that I messed up on, a mistake that I made, and I'll write that down. I didn't get back to someone soon enough. I forgot to do this, or whatever it is. And then I go back over that column of lessons learned and I look for ways that I can improve. I ask myself, what character or virtue goal can I set for the month that will ameliorate that deficit so it doesn't happen again? Wow. And just by paying attention, there's an immediate correction. Just by being self-aware, what did I do right and what do I need to improve in, and keeping track of that, I think that gives good information. So anyways,
I love that. That is absolutely right answer to my question. That's a way to help you keep thriving, is the accountability factor that you do. I love that idea. And those two things that you ask yourself, pretty good, pretty good. Let's do the admin part of the show, because we're going to have a fun time on Fun Street with Scott.
Okay, great.
Share with the listeners all the places people can find you, websites, URLs, things coming out. Listeners, I know it's Valentine's Day and you're listening to this going, my goodness, I got Scott Love on today, which is rather fitting. anything coming up in the near future, we will put it in the show notes, but it gets more engagement when they hear it from you.
Yep. So if you go to www.thesalescasino.com, you'll see my speaking site. I hired your company, Lou, Callie, with her company, Manifestive Design, to do a fantastic job with that site. And that was a very good recommendation. Thesalescasino.com. My legal recruiting business is attorneysearchgroup.com. So if you're a partner or law firm leader and you want to chat, you can reach me there. But, and for everybody else, therainmakingpodcast.com. You'll find all the episodes there. If you're an expert in business development, reach out to me that way. And then also, Lou, I'll make sure you have my LinkedIn link so that people can connect with me on that.
Mr. Scott Love. I was going to say Dr. Scott Love, because in one of his comedy bits, he wishes he was Dr. Love, you know, Dr. Love, which would be great. PhD,
Dr. Love, Dr. Love.
So first, and also I'll give another shout out to Callie, who is a guest on Thrive Loud from Manifested Design, and go check out, she did a great job on Scott's site. Really awesome. Awesome stuff. Callie, you may have done a better job on his site than mine. No. Equally good.
I don't know.
Equally good.
It's all good.
All right, so we're going to do Fun Street here. And we're going to start off with something that when I saw the response, I said, one, we've never had this answer before, but two, it was like a wow. Share with the listener, Scott. What is your all-time favorite movie?
12 O'Clock High.
Okay, and why does that movie connect so much with you?
It's a story about leadership effectiveness, about that we all get caught up in the emotion and we don't make effective decisions. And you see that, and I don't want to give it away if you haven't seen it. It's Gregory Peck. How could you not like a movie about World War II with Gregory Peck in it? First saw that when I was a midshipman at the Naval Academy. During our summer classes, we would study leadership by watching movies because it's summertime and you don't have to put in 22 credit hours during the summer. So that was it, 12 O'Clock High.
I love it. Now, I had one question because I thought maybe this one would have leaked in, maybe not as a favorite as Gregory Peck, but it is a recent one and you probably would appreciate it, relatively recent, within the last 10, 12 years. Are you a fan of the movie Annapolis?
Hadn't seen it.
Oh, I guess my God. We got to put it on your list. So,
well, I heard it wasn't filmed there, so I just didn't.
Well, yeah, they had some aerial shots of it there, but it was basically the big boxing competition that they have at Annapolis, which I think they do have. Whatever.
Well, I was on the debate team. I was on
the boxing, but it was good. It was a good bit. Actually, there was parts of it that I liked. I thought it was good. But yes, they did not film it there. They filmed it at some other place. I think they could not film what they wanted to do there. So, all right, it was a shot. But it doesn't compare to 12 O'Clock High. I want to make that clear. Much better movie.
Right.
Better message. Okay. We're going to do the speed round here on Fun Street. And everyone knows how it goes. But you are a pro at this. So here's how we do it. I'm going to ask you something. I want the first thing that comes to your mind. These are things that lift you up, motivate you. Basically, they make you thrive. All right.
Sure.
Of late, Scott Love, a song that you love to listen to or one that pumps you up?
I like to listen to classical. I like, I'm an artist. I paint watercolors and I'm taking oil lessons. And I listen to a lot of Vivaldi, a lot of Baroque music. So that's something that I love. And then I also love Billy Idol. So there's your...
There we go. Okay.
Yeah. That's anything awesome. By Billy Idol. Yeah.
A favorite food that's not a dessert?
Indian food.
Oh, which dish do you like? Anyone in particular?
I like chicken curry.
Yeah. Yeah. That's a good one. A favorite dessert?
Martini.
Best answer ever.
Yeah, right.
Because a martini is a dessert. Not a drink. Favorite dessert is a martini. I love it. An activity you wish you did more of?
Painting.
An activity you wish you did less of?
I would say chores. But, I mean, in my home...
Okay.
Doing dishes is foreplay.
I got it. Okay, now. Well played. An activity you've recently tried and want to recommend to everybody.
Art. I would say paint. Okay. Winston Churchill wrote a book called Painting as a Pastime.
Yeah.
When you're focused on something, you need to take a break. You can't just say, I'm going to sit here and do nothing. Focus on something like art, and it will give you healing and strength.
If I could snap my fingers and Scott Love can be anywhere in the world. Where is he?
It would be in Paris taking art lessons.
Oh, that's a nice.
Yeah.
Listeners, I'm just going to say it because I thought about it with all his well-roundedness. I think you're the Renaissance rainmaking man. I think that's what you're, the Renaissance rainmaker. I think that's we think we just renamed this episode is what we might do.
Sounds good. I'll take it.
Scott,
I'll take it.
A pleasure to have you on, my friend. Great to have you. Everyone check out all the links and get them on your stages where you need to. And more notably, if you're a law firm out there and you need some good people, you want to engage, or you're looking for good talent, or you're a lawyer looking to figure out the next thing, find this guy. He's the guy to get you where you need to be.
Thank you, Lou.
You got it, man. To all the listeners out there, thank you for joining us. And until next time, keep moving onward and upward. And remember, be brief, be bright, be gone.
You've been listening to Thrive Loud with your host, Lou Diamond. Check us out on the web at thriveloud.com and follow us on Instagram, LinkedIn, Twitter, and Facebook at Thrive Loud. And check us out on the Good Pods app at Thrive Loud, where you can follow, listen, and connect directly to Lou and all of the Thrive Loud episodes. Thanks for listening.